H1 is conjugate to one of the form (1, 0, e to the 2 pi i gamma 0). Because there is one solution which is holomorphic, one maybe not, and it always has this form. So we said that such a thing is what's called a complex reflection. So it's a complex reflection. So let me just state the result whose proof I have sort of only sketched. Suppose the y1 of c minus of t1 minus 0, 1, infinity is the free group on three generators modulo this relation. The action of the monodromy action of pi 1 on the space of solutions to star are such that H naught is conjugate. I will just write this, it means it's conjugate to e to the 2 pi I alpha 1 or beta 1. H infinity is conjugate to e to the 2 pi I alpha 2, and so let me call this matrix A inverse and call this B, and H1, which is B inverse A, is a complex reflection. And conversely, suppose I am given two matrices A and B, which have eigenvalue C to the 2 pi I beta 1, E to the 2 pi I beta 2 here, and the other matrix has eigenvalues like this, such that the B inverse A is a complex reflection, then it corresponds to the monodromy of a hypergeometric equation. You just plug in, find the values of alpha 1 and alpha 2, and plug that in, that's it. So there's a 1-1 correspondence between homomorphisms of the free group on three generators modulo this relation into GL to C with these conditions and hypergeometric differential equations. So you can forget entirely about the differential equations and concentrate on the on such representations. There is one more important part of the theorem which I haven't yet stated, I'll do it now. That's called the rigidity statement. So suppose, so I'm going to make some what is called a genericity assumption. We will assume A, B as here, as in 2, have no common eigenvalue. Okay, in other words, alpha I minus beta j is not an integer. So suppose rho is any representation. Let's call this group F GL2C is any representation so that rho of H0 is A naught, rho of H infinity naught. Eigenvalues of B naught equal to so here I said there is a monodromy representation whose monodromy matrices have these as eigenvalues. Suppose you consider any representation with these as eigenvalues such that B inverse A is complex reflection. Suppose I have any representation like this. I have one representation like this for monodromy, and suppose I consider any other representation, then that representation is conjugate to this one. There is only one representation up to conjugacy. Then there exists a matrix in GL2C such that rho of x is m, call this monodromy action tau, not tau, rho naught. M rho naught x, m inverse, for all x. So what it's saying is the following. I know that B and B naught are conjugate. I know that A and A naught are conjugate, right? Because they both have the same eigenvalues. If A and A naught are conjugate, B and B naught are conjugate, such that B naught inverse A naught is the same, is a complex reflection, and as is B inverse A, then B naught and A naught are simultaneously conjugate. That's what this says. B naught is conjugate to B, A naught is conjugate to A by a fixed matrix M. That's what this is saying. So the proof of it is very easy. What we will show is that if there is no common eigenvalue, so let me prove the part three, which is actually more useful to us. What we will show is that there is a unique represent, if there is one representation at all, such a representation is unique up to conjugacy. So as I said, I'm going to assume that they have no common eigenvalue. That is important to us. Yes, one more thing I will say without defining it. The representation rho or irreducible. If alpha I minus beta j. So let me just give the sketch the proof of this part only. We have sort of proved this part. We computed monodromy at zero, computed monodromy at infinity, and we said this had such a shape. So proof of three is what we need. So suppose epsilon 1 is non-zero and fixed by C naught. You see, let me recall the assumption. I said that such a matrix is a complex reflection. In other words, this matrix with respect to some basis looks like that. So there is a vector which is fixed, so I just start with that vector. So I have a naught epsilon 1, let me call this epsilon 2, which is also v naught epsilon 1, because c naught fixes that vector. So a naught inverse b naught of epsilon 1 equals. Now you see, if epsilon 2 is a scalar multiple of epsilon 1, then they will have a common eigenvector. So epsilon 2 can't be a scalar multiple of epsilon 1. So this means that epsilon 1, epsilon 2 are linearly independent. So with respect to the basis, we compute the action of A naught and B naught with respect to this basis. So let's look at the matrix of A naught. Whatever it is, it's like this. And A naught of epsilon 2 is A naught squared of epsilon 1. But A naught squared is trace of A naught. Right? So A naught acting on epsilon 2 is trace of A naught times epsilon 2 minus determinant of A naught times epsilon 1. So I'm just writing the matrix, it's something easy. And similarly B. But you see, if the eigenvalues of B naught, which are all distinct, are fixed, then all these traces and determinants are fixed. So we have got that with respect to some basis, the matrices of A naught and B naught are completely determined by just this information. Right? Therefore, there is only one representation. And irreducibility is easy, so I won't do it again. So we can, as I said, we can completely stop thinking about differential equations. We just want to understand representations such that B inverse A is a complex reflection and these eigenvalues are specified. That's it. So now if I want to understand when the monodromy group is finite, it's the same thing as asking when the group generated by such two such matrices is a finite group. Your question? When is, that is, for what values? Beta 1, beta 2, alpha 2. The group generated by the matrices A naught, B naught, a finite group. But in fact, I'm not going to work this out because the parameters are a little bit complicated the way I'm thinking about it. Maybe there is a simpler way, but we will reduce it to some question in sort of elementary number theory. So before doing this, I'm just repeating, by the way, the proof that is in standard books. This is something well known. Maybe as a reference, there is a paper, fairly recent paper by Macmillan, Matt and Allen. I don't know, one of these two. So if you look at this, he has a paper called Braid Groups in Hodge Theory. And there is a little section on finiteness of monodromy, and a very nice proof using pictures, in fact. So it's a very nice proof. So you might like to take a look at this. But the proof I'm going to sketch is much more much more algebraic, but I understand it, so I'm going to sketch that. So the strategy is actually motivated by what he's doing. What happens is that once I'm given this information, if I want to say when this group is finite, it happens that if I want it to be a finite group, first of all, these eigenvalues, beta and alpha, must be rational numbers. That's easy to see. And once that happens, I will show how these matrices must preserve a Hermitian form. And if you want to test when a group is finite, what you want to do is to test when the Hermitian form which it preserves is positive definite. So we'll just check that. That's very easy. So the Hermitian form which is left invariant by both B naught and A naught for the rational values of beta I should be a positive definite Hermitian form. And not just positive definite for one value, for all, so to speak, Galois twists, it should be positive definite. So I'll come to that question. So the strategy of the proof is to cook up a Hermitian form on C2 reserved by A0, B0, and checking that the Hermitian form is, I will explain this at some point, I think, totally positive. So let me keep this So what I want to understand is, when is the group generated by A naught and B naught a finite group? In other words, in particular, A naught and B naught should have finite order, right? So if A naught and B naught should have finite order, that means that their eigenvalues should be roots of unity. So if the eigenvalue should be a root of unity, that means that the numbers alpha and beta should be rational. So first requirement. Alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, a rational number. So what I'm going to do is to prove this. See, when you say a Hermitian form is preserved, what we are really saying is that if I have a representation on which some group which is acting preserves a Hermitian form, I take the bar representation which I've defined, that is all matrices are replaced by their complex conjugate entities. The bar representation must be isomorphic to the dual. If this happens, then it preserves a Hermitian form. Okay, so we have to check, if I take the bar representation and take its dual, whether it is isomorphic to the original representation or not. So let us look at this matrix A naught. Okay, it's like this. By the way, nothing is new. All this is well known. Even the strategy is known. I'm just organizing the proof accordingly. That's all. It's not like I have done anything new here. Okay, so I start with this matrix. See, this is a sum of roots of unity. So it is conjugate. E to the 2 pi I alpha 1, e to the 2 pi I alpha 2. So if I take transpose A naught bar inverse, if I take such a matrix, this is conjugate. When I take transpose, nothing changes because it's diagonal. So if I take everything by conjugate, because alpha is a rational, it becomes e to the minus 2 pi I alpha. But when I also take its inverse, nothing changes, so I get the same. And similarly, transpose of beta naught bar inverse is conjugate to e to the 2 pi I beta 1. But we have to check one more condition, that the, so call this A prime, call this B prime. So I have two matrices with the correct eigenvalue. What about A prime inverse B prime, or B prime inverse A prime? I claim that that has eigenvalue 1. Is this clear? Because if I take the transpose inverse looks like minus 1 something something here. Inverse 0, minus 1, 0. Right? If I take the transpose inverse of this, 1 becomes minus 1 there, and so on. Is that okay? But then, therefore, you see, it has the am I getting stuck here? Yeah, excuse me. So the conjugated representation fixes the same vector epsilon. The bar representation fixes the same vector epsilon 1. So the dually, it fixes a vector, namely its dual. So that's all I'm saying. So this is a complex reflection. It's a complex reflection because it is transpose C naught bar inverse. Yeah, that's all. It's a complex reflection because it is the transpose bar inverse of a complex reflection. Yeah, we don't worry about this matrix form, sorry. It is, the C naught was conjugate to a matrix of the form like this. So C naught bar inverse is conjugate. So it's certainly a complex reflection. See, I'm not claiming here that this has finite order. We don't know that yet. We want to prove this. So in particular, it's just a complex reflection. So it has eigenvalue 1. So we have one more representation, namely the transpose bar inverse representation, which has the same properties as the old one. So it must be conjugate to the old one because of this uniqueness theorem. So there exists a matrix M in GL2C such that transpose A bar inverse by this uniqueness theorem. Is this clear? See, I have just taken the transpose bar inverse and the transpose bar inverse of C naught is also a complex reflection because it has the same shape. And therefore, that is a representation which satisfies all our conditions, so there must exist such a matrix. So instead of saying it for each A naught and B naught separately, transpose X bar inverse is M, X, M inverse, for all X in the group generated by A naught and B naught. Let me call this the monodromy group. So I can make transpose bar inverse once more. Yeah, I can just replace everything here by transpose bar inverse. So this implies transpose of a transpose is identity. Inverse of inverse is also identity. So I just get X equals transpose M bar inverse. And apply this equality once more. So transpose M bar inverse, M, X, M inverse, transpose M bar. So I have a new matrix, N, such that N commutes with X. So such an N must be a scalar. So let me repeat this. I'm saying that if I have an irreducible representation of a group, that is, this group acts irreducibly on C2, there is no line which is fixed, and I have a matrix which commutes with all the matrices of the subgroup, that matrix must be a scalar matrix. Schur's lemma, does everyone know Schur's lemma? No, so let me just state this. So let me quickly recall, a group G in GL and C is said to act irreducibly from C to the N if W not equal to 0 is a subspace of C to the N such that G of W is contained in W for all matrices G in the subgroup. W equals C to the N. So whenever I have a subspace which is invariant under all the group elements, then that subspace must be the whole space. Okay, such a thing is called an irreducible representation. For example, suppose I take N equal to 1, the only non-zero subspace is the whole space, so it is always irreducible, one-dimensional representation. And if I take GL and C, that acts irreducibly on C to the N, because if I have a subspace, any non-zero vector can be taken to any other non-zero vector under the action of a non-singular linear transformation, because any basis element can be taken to any other. So GL and C, for example, acts irreducibly on C to the N. So various groups act, and you say that a group acts irreducibly if this condition holds. Okay. Suppose G is a subgroup of GL and C. G acts irreducibly on C to the N. T from C to the N to C to the N is a linear map such that Tx, Xt. Then T is a scalar. So we are here, so we want to keep this. Proof is again very easy, because what you do is to locate some eigenspace for T. Every linear transformation on C to the N, because C is algebraically closed, has an eigenvector with some eigenvalue lambda. So fix the lambda eigenspace for T. And you will see that that lambda eigenspace is an invariant subspace, is a subspace of this type, and therefore it has to be everything. Okay, so that W equals V in C to the N is the T of V. There exists lambda not equal to 0. Such that if W is non-zero, the lambda eigenspace is non-zero, there exists such a thing because every linear transformation has an eigenspace, has an eigenvector. So let's look at G acting on V, and let's see what happens to T. So T of G is G of T. That's what we are given. So this implies that G of W is contained in W. But that exactly means that by irreducibility assumption, this implies that W equals C to the N. and T of V equals lambda V for all V in C to the N. So this implies T is a scalar. That's what we wanted to prove, that T is a scalar matrix. So here, M inverse transpose M bar is a scalar matrix. So consequently, equals a scalar. But if I, this means that transpose M bar is lambda times M. So if I take transpose bar one more time, then I get lambda transpose M bar. This is scalar, scalar matrix, so the transpose is itself lambda bar lambda M. This implies lambda bar times lambda equals 1. So if I have a complex number of absolute value 1, I can write it as mu bar. I can write it as mu by mu bar for some mu in C. This is Hilbert 90. So this transformation N, which is transpose M bar inverse M, is mu bar by mu. So this implies that mu times M is transpose mu times M bar. So it's a Hermitian matrix. So what we have got is that this matrix is Hermitian. So M, not M, H equals transpose X bar HX for all X in the monodromy group. So your monodromy group actually preserves such a Hermitian form. I think my time is up, no? So the issue is to actually actually prove that this Hermitian form is positive definite, but it's very easy in the case of two dimensions because the Hermitian form is conjugate to a real matrix. So if I want to prove that it's positive definite, what I want to do is it's a scalar multiple of something positive definite. All I want to show is that A2 by A1 is positive. But A2 by A1 is A1 A2 by A1 squared. So it is determinant divided by A1 squared, one of the eigenvalues. And you just show that this is totally positive. Okay? And there's an explicit expression for the Hermitian form. So don't ask me why, because that will take me too much. If I take alpha 1 minus alpha 2, I'll write it as this, beta 1 minus beta 2. And the this number, which I'm trying to prove is positive, will look like this. So some number like this should be positive, and in fact, I can replace it by any Galois conjugate. Multiply all these numbers by a certain J, which is coprime to D. So some number like this will be positive. This value is exactly this value. So that we prove that, and you can also show that that list is finite. Maybe I should have given that statement. There is a list called Schwarz's list, which tells you the following. So, lambda is 1 minus k1 plus k2 by d. Then, if I take lambda, see the parameters are different, that's why the I couldn't translate it properly into our this half mu let me forget this case. So lambda mu nu, it is in these parameters. The values are half, one third, 2/3, 1/3, 1/3, half, 1/3, 1/3, and so on, 1/3, 1/4. So there is a list like this. I will just leave it here. You can come and take a look. This is stolen from Wikipedia. So okay, I better stop here. I thought I could sketch the proof of this, but it took me too long.